someone within the group came up with an idea to do a fan film. And I had done a lot of fan films in the past. I sort of jumped at the chance to do some more. Literally, at the first meeting, I got asked whether I would play the Doctor, at which point I ripped someone's hand off and said, yes, of course I would. And ever since then, I have, well, made sure it happens.
Just an idea to get into doing a fan film. We just wanted to do something, and it came about that Steve had a few ideas and I had a few ideas, and they were pretty much the same idea at the same time. So we got our heads together, both wrote treatments, and Steve finished it off with all the dialogue.
I went away, started writing it, had absolutely no chance of writing the story that I was supposed to write. Started having a think and came up with a ghost story, based on sort of Most Haunted.
As far back as records go, there have always been reports of strange noises, disembodied voices, objects moving or just not being where they're supposed to be, and all without rational explanation. With our team of experts, we have just one night to establish the truth. I'm Macy Ferguson, and this is The Other Side.
Well, this episode is a very simple episode. The Doctor turns up, and there's a brand new series about supernatural goings-on. It's called The Other Side.
The TARDIS lands, having found an anomaly in space and time, and it's that anomaly that they're causing the ghosts.
When he gets involved, he finds out that there's something other than just the paranormal that's going on.
There is literally something on the other side trying to get through, something from another dimension which the Doctor has to stop.
He's very good. He kind of reminds me of my geography teacher at school.
I'm the Doctor.
Yeah, he's quite impressive. He's got it down to pat. It was his script. He wrote it himself, so he knows how he wanted to play it from the start.
Hello. Steve does a good job. Yeah, he does a good job, yeah. But I would have played him a lot better if they selected me. Unfortunately, I have this thing called a waste problem. Which means I can't fit through the TARDIS.
He's very, very good. You're brilliant, Doctor.
Steve is very good as the Doctor.
Well, you built a console in the TARDIS, so if he wants to be the Doctor, let him be the Doctor.
He's amazing. Wonderful character. Off camera and on camera, he's brilliant. Good part.
He is quite a character. He's very McCoy.
Sylvester McCoy? A slightly McCoy.
Wow, he's no McCoy, is he? He's not the real McCoy, I should say.
My Doctor is most like, I'm going to bottle that one and say I think he's a mix of all of them.
William Hartnell.
I think on paper, his speeches come off as a cross between
Troughton, Davison,
Colin Baker,
Colin and Pertwee.
I like to think he's a bit
Paul McGann,
Eccleston,
Tom Baker, a bit David Tennant,
Matt Smith.
That is very clever.
An awful lot of everybody mixed into one.
I mean, he brings his own style to the role, and seems to enjoy it.
I'm the show's scientific advisor.
I think that's what you're being paid for.
Do you have a spare monitor?
Well, this one here, but it's not working, really.
Could you record that for me?
You want me to record the static?
Yes.
Whatever you want.
Thank you.
Ah.
There you go, I'm not sure. Oh, that's okay, guys. I don't mind being left alone in a haunted house.
He's a little bit more, I think, off the wall, the fact that he'll just go off at a complete tangent. David Tennant goes a little way to say he'll spark an idea. But this one, he just literally will go off at a tangent, say something, go off at 90 degrees, have a complete talk about that, and then come back to the subject in hand.
So, what's with the tuning fork?
Just testing.
And testing for what?
Find the right resonant frequency, you could trigger a manifestation. Well, that's the theory anyway. Psychic phenomena are often imprinted on the local environment.
You're serious? A tuning fork to summon ghosts?
Absolutely. Well, not summon them exactly. What we have here is a weakness in the fabric of space-time, which, to a greater or lesser extent, allows a past time zone to intersect with the present.
You're serious?
I am your scientific advisor.
But that's ridiculous.
You have a better explanation?
Love him. He was a pain. Awful. Would never work with him again.
I am Gemma Bassett, and I'm playing Macy Ferguson, who presents The Other Side. And I forgot its name then.
The companion for the episode, which is Macy Ferguson, who's a TV presenter who started out with children's TV.
After 2 years of working with sticky black plastic, over-enthusiastic kids, and a flatulent border collie, I think I can ad-lib my way through anyone.
Good girl.
We've tried to create a character who is a modern companion, but also is a little bit peril sensitive, in the fact that she does get taken over. She doesn't actually trip over and sprain her ankle, because that she doesn't scream, but she is a bit forthright and feisty.
Well, I'm sensible.
Don't you get sanctimonious with me, Macy.
We still have a television programme to make.
Yeah, and Alexi's on the verge of a nervous breakdown.
Well, he's going to be even more at stake when he's drunk.
But also she has a slight sort of human vulnerability to her, which is quite good.
After what's been going on here this evening, anything's possible.
You were watching?
Since I joined the delegated, yep.
Okay, we cut there.
Gemma was good. She got into it. She really, really enjoyed herself.
I think she plays it brilliantly, actually, because, again, she does something completely different.
Macy, this is ground control. Can you hear me? Over.
Yes, I can hear you. Do you want something, or are you just being a pain in the ass?
Just doing a quick sound check. I want to make sure I've got everything working. And if you could just say a few words.
Don't tempt me.
When it came to doing ADR, I think she was the top of the class for that. So that was a very good moment for Mark when he was trying to arrange the dubbing. Didn't always remember a line.
I'll take your word for that.
discredit me.
Not at all. I try to keep an open mind about the paranormal.
Good. Then we may get along.
I am Alexei Rushenko, psychic and medium.
A psychic is Alexei Rushenko, who might not be exactly what he says he is, but I don't want to go into that too much right now.
Lawrence plays Alexei Rushenko, who... but that's not his real name. He's actually a medium, and very much in the style of sort of Derek Acora or somebody like that. He's the television program's resident medium, but he actually is for real, and he does see things and hear things. He accurately predicts the Doctor's arrival, although no one actually realises it at the time.
He's coming.
Who's coming, Alexei?
The one who is all powerful. He who watched as Rome fell and wept as London was consumed by flames.
He also senses the ghosts that are haunting the fort as part of the breach in the fabric of time. And towards the end, he actually senses this dark presence that is also trying to come through. And, well, he has a key part to play in the story resolution.
A ghost?
A spirit trapped by events.
Can you communicate with the child?
He is frightened.
Interested in writing some stuff for what we're doing, and then they said, it was Steve, said, oh, by the way, I wrote this one with you, this character with you in mind. So I said, oh, alright then, and since nobody else was there, that's how I got hooked in.
Ah, Lawrence was brilliant. I think he's really the star of the episode. His character, what he brought to that character is brilliant. And maybe if you stay tuned to the rest of the series, you might hear his voice one more time.
Come in, Doctor.
That is very clever.
Say about his real identity?
What do you mean?
Well, rumour is he's not really a Romanian gypsy, in fact Kevin Dibley from Norwich.
And then we have the comedy relief of our technical crew, portrayed very well by a man who's done a lot of hard work behind the scenes, Mark.
Well, I am Mark, and I am playing Mark. The hardest part of this job was trying to learn the character name, of course.
You just don't know the half of it.
I'm playing the sound technician and the general busybody of the piece. My job is to watch the footage, make sure it's okay, and then report back if anything's gone wrong.
What the hell?
It started off a long time ago, almost a year and a half ago now. The idea of a fan film was suggested on Plymouth Who. And I've seen hundreds of fan films, I've collected them over the years, particularly during the wilderness years when Doctor Who wasn't on TV, and when I first had a computer and I was 18 and I didn't have much of a social life. I've always wanted to make one, and I jumped on the chance.
Earth calling Mark.
I am seeing patterns in the static myself now. I can see, I'm looking at these eyes, take the glasses off. I'm sure if you zoom in find that they're pixelated now. I'm sure I don't have retina anymore, they're just squares.
Why don't we get in on the act?
Smile, you miserable bugger.
Oh well, I agreed to the job, so I knew what was coming. That's probably more of a pain than looking at the static.
Hello.
Right. You punch me in the face, I'll take it out soon. May we?
They're here.
Where are we?
Do something useful today.
My name's Melanie and I play Joe, the producer.
We have the director of the series, Joe Atkins, who's a very mothering figure for all of them. Really, there's a touching moment between her and our psychic.
You don't understand.
I'm trying to. You've got real talent, but you're just throwing it all away. The others, they're just shams and fakes, but you're the real thing. You're throwing it all away.
My name's Andrew, and I'm playing Jules, cameraman.
Jesus, you scared them. Can I help you, mate?
This all looks very interesting. Are you making a film?
I wish. Television.
I'm Zoe, and I play Izzy, the makeup artist.
Izzy, there you are. I need you to start working on Alexa, I'm going to meet him soon. Oh, while you're there, I know it's not your job, but please try and get through some coffee or something.
Hi, my name is Kriss Ellis-Stansfield, and I play a small part in the film, really just an extra, and I help out cameras and so on, basically just one of the film crew.
I'm Gina, and my role is, well, today it's been behind camera, and later on in the series I'm going to be playing Ellie, who's another companion.
We've both known Steve for a long time, and he asked us if we could come on board, and I also help write some of the script as well, so...
I find it really, really interesting. I mean, they're all a wonderful group of people.
Very impressive. They're very well organised. They've got a great team.
It's been a really, really wonderful experience. It's been really good.
Thank you.
TARDIS is recycled from a much earlier project that Steve did, so it was all his own work. He had to touch it up and repaint it.
It took me a couple of weeks of evenings, really. I had the framework of it, in the sense that I had, for a previous fan film that I'd been doing, had a police box built, or my father helped me build a police box. My father was a carpenter. But it had been literally in the back of my garage for 10 years, and when this production was mentioned, I dug it out and dusted it off, and it had got damp at one point, and the base had rotted. The whole of the, every single side of the police box had rotted on the side, the edge that had been touching the floor. So it wasn't a complete build from scratch. It was a partial rebuild and building new corner pieces and a new roof, which had fallen by the wayside during storage.
But it's all his, and it does look good. And it is a real TARDIS that's there, I promise. It was quite relieving, because when we actually got it up, it was raining. And if you have a look in the scene where the TARDIS materialises, there's a slight gap between the sky, because Mark had to do some amazing jiggery-pokery to try and match them up.
Chris did a sterling job, actually, because it actually was his first time directing.
Yeah, this is the first time we tried it. That's why it was just testing the waters. About a year and a half ago now, I put the first message up on the forum. Of course, Steve's done it loads of times, so he's leading us by the hand for these first few products.
I think Chris has been brilliantly directed by Steve.
I'm a bit of an old hat at hand at this, and I really did have to keep apologising, because I did want to keep taking over and saying, why don't we do this, why don't we do that? And he did quite patiently say to me, shall I go home at one point?
Until he saw the t-shirt that I made, especially for the first day.
And from then I bit my tongue and waited till he finished the scene and then made little suggestions, rather than jumping in and saying, let's do this now, let's do that now. But for the next one, I'm directing it.
Chris is doing a brilliant job. Steve is doing a not so good job of trying to stand back and let Chris direct. But Chris is doing a very good job, and for a first film, for the first time, he's stupendously planned. He's a lot more planned than I would be.
Very bossy. Dreadful. I think we should sack him.
I haven't actually seen a lot of his work, but the stuff that I've seen purely today and yesterday has been really good.
He's done storyboards, he's done camera setups, he's done shooting scripts. All I would do is a shooting script and direct on the day.
Given that I don't think he's done it before, he's doing very well. Performed admirably.
I hope my first attempt at directing isn't too bad. I'm sure there'll be people out there who hate it, but I hope there'll be some good responses from it.
It's his first film, he hasn't done anything like this before, so top credit to him.
Well, the first day's filming we did was a rush. The amount of crew we had was very, very limited. It was pretty much me and anyone who wasn't on screen at the time. So I spent most of my time running around, turning cameras on and off.
We had two absolutely brilliant locations. We filmed at Whiteway Wilkinson's, which is at Egbuckland Keep, which is an old Palmerston fort. Virtually unchanged. It's a builder's merchant now. They just use the grounds for storage, and they just let us in for £20 for a day, and we were literally in there the the whole day. We had to take our own lighting rig in. It was pretty dank and dirty, but it was the brilliant location. It's exactly what we wanted.
The second day's filming, second and third, were a lot better because we had a lot more people roped in to help out, and there was a lot more people behind the scenes.
We are in Eggbuckland Fort, which is not Eggbuckland Fort, Woodland Fort. We were in Eggbuckland Fort last time, which is a community centre, which is where we're supposed to be filming all of the sort of main room scenes and Alexei's dressing room.
Which is another Palmerston Fort. This time it's actually been converted into a social club. Still being used. And again, brilliant location, filmed over 2 days. That literally broke the back of the entire story.
We're doing everything which involves Mark being all possessed and weird. We're doing all the kind of deep and meaningful scenes with Alexei and Joe. And I'm just about to go outside and do my sort of walking down the steps, walking and talking scene, which happens at the very beginning. But it's dry at the moment, so we've got to do it now while the weather holds.
Just setting up for Alexei's office shots. I'll try and get the tripod to work, which I can't do. And then we'll be filming all the ones inside his dressing room office.
Try not to move your face too much.
Scene at this location, and then we're just left with the TARDIS interiors to do next weekend.
Post-production, which has gone on and on and on.
Making the episode, to be honest, the whole thing was just done so fast, and we never really got a feeling of what it was going to be until we got very far into it. So I think originally making it was it was so over our top of our heads, and we were so in there doing it didn't feel like anything.
I don't know, I'm not really seeing it as Doctor Who at the moment. I'm seeing it as a load of people messing around with a few cameras. But I suppose it'll be quite cool when it's all put together and you see the whole story playing out and things. So.
Now we've sat back and we've looked at it and we're now planning the score for it and things like that, it does feel like it's coming together like a real episode.
Absolutely brilliant.
The Other Side is a fake, Most Haunted style ghost hunting documentary series. It's fake because we made it up, and hopefully, fingers crossed, people aren't going to get mad with us because we've been promoting it as a real ghost hunting series.
Is this place unoccupied, deserted, but not uninhabited?
How many of them are there?
There were four. Three of them died here.
Well, I wanted to test the waters for doing a viral idea, and we thought, well, seeing as we had this series of The Other Side, we had the cast and the crew and the ideas behind it already set up, why not just put it out there as an idea for a TV series and see if people got interested in that, and then hopefully we'd get more people who came over to watch the actual episode than people sending us hate mail.
Is there anything here?
Something. What is? Yes. Secret tryst here. The fort's administrator. He comes here.
What, still, or...?
No, he has passed on. He comes here for secret affair with woman from the village.
Right.
Here, they do what is needful.
Yes, I do apologise, and the emails will come to my email box, and I don't read it that often, but when I do, I will try and apologise to as many people as possible.
Okay.
Okay, so we're on the roof of the fort now. Is there anything that you can pick up here?
This one. De La Rowney number 14, sable in the eye. This one, brutal revenge sticker.
A revenge stippling!
A brutal revenge stippling!
Is there anyone in this room right now?
The Other Side is the first episode. The second, third and fourth episodes are all audio stories, which will be up on the internet somewhere at some point soon.
Episodes 5 and 6 are still being written. We're actually doing film episode 7. Up to now, we set the scene. We introduce all the characters that are needed to take us through, and all the scenarios which are needed to take us through to the finale, because there is a two-part grand finale which we're setting up even as we speak.
Well, the first episode for the second series is already being written, so we've got a few ideas bounded around for that.
There are some trailers actually on YouTube at the moment for the video project. The three audios that we are currently editing will eventually go on to YouTube, and there is a number of Doctor Who fan film, fan production websites which are linked to currently from Gallifrey One, which will take you straight to where these productions are hosted or will be hosted when they're completed. There are a number of other very good productions there. Hopefully we will rank amongst those, and we will welcome any feedback when it happens. We're trying to replicate the formula of the current Doctor Who series in the sense that we have a complete story arc. We have reoccurring characters, so hopefully instead of the old days where you had a few episodes, complete new change of cast, change of scenery, characters do come back time and again. Some in a good way, some in a bad way, some in a completely different way. And each story will build towards the finale, so stick with the series once you get there, and hopefully there will be a payoff at the end and something quite catastrophic that happens towards the end. I'm not going to give too much away, but stick with it. The next live action is called Incursion. Again, it, as mentioned previously, it sets up another number of characters which are required later on in the series. We meet Ellie, who is a UNIT operative. UNIT is mentioned in passing during the story. They vaguely appear towards the end, and that sets up another story which comes a little bit later. The story involves basically there has been a spaceship that's crash landed in a rural environment. units aren't particularly aware of it. They are looking at the bigger picture and have seen a larger spacecraft crash somewhere else, which they are containing. And the small scout ship has an alien which is running amok near a small country village.